If you've done the right thing to keep yourself and others safe, to look after one another, you should feel safe. You should be protected from those who haven't made that choice.
That was Jacinda Ardern discussing vaccination certificates, which will soon be a big part of our lives. As recently as August, the Prime Minister ruled out using vaccination certificates, despite versions being in widespread use overseas. Now, vaccine certificates will make up the backbone of the traffic light system. Associate Professor Angela Ballantyne is a bioethicist on the government's Immunisation Implementation Advisory Group, and she is with us this morning from Wellington. Tēnā koe. From an ethical perspective, what do you think of the government's plans for vaccination certificates?
Kia ora and good morning. I'm really pleased you chose to share that particular quote from the Prime Minister, because I think that highlights some of my concerns. The most important part of our response to COVID, and one of the reasons that it's been so successful in New Zealand, has been the focus on collective interests, unity, kotahitanga, and really working as one. And so I think a major risk with the vaccine certificates or passports is that they are divisive. And so I think that quote from the Prime Minister really started to highlight that narrative around there are the people that have made the right decision, and then there are the others, and we need to be protected from them. So now that we're in a place where, you know, that rhetoric really labels some New Zealanders as threats to other New Zealanders, I think that's problematic. And that's a real departure, I think, from what we've seen from the government so far. I think Ashley Bloomfield's been fantastic in continually reminding everybody that the threat is the virus, it's not people. So we, you know, at all costs want to avoid stigmatising certain sectors of New Zealand, pushing them further to the margins and labelling them as a threat to the rest of us.
So vaccine certificates are in widespread use overseas. Do they make sense from an epidemiological perspective as we respond to the virus?
Yeah, so they are in place overseas, that's a good point. I think one thing I'd love to see from the government is a clearer ethical justification for the use of the certificates, because there's a few options. You could justify them on public health grounds, but under those circumstances you need some evidence that they're going to be effective and to what extent they're actually going to reduce transmission. So some of the principles of public health ethics that would be relevant here are the idea of least infringement or proportionality. So when you're going to restrict individuals' liberty by saying they can't access certain community and social spaces, that needs to be justified to the extent to which the benefits outweigh the risks, and also that it's the least restrictive measure possible to achieve your goal. So I haven't seen specific modelling, for example, that compares the ongoing use of masks versus vaccine certificate. Alternatively, a second ethical framework is a sort of moral rights framework, which is what some of those comments from the Prime Minister seem to be hinting at, that if you've made a wrong choice or you've done something wrong, you no longer have the liberty and the freedom to have certain privileges. I think that's really problematic and we should avoid that. The third possibility is a utilitarian framework. So sometimes under utilitarianism, we would say that the end can justify the means. But it's really important then that we know what the end is and what the goal that we're working towards is. So it's not clear to me whether this is primarily designed to be a carrot that gets us up to 90% or a stick after we get to 90% to encourage those who remain unvaccinated to get vaccinated. And then I'd like to know what the goal point is, what we're aiming for.
Can you tell me a little bit more about that second concern you just outlined, the one you said was problematic? Because there will be people who say, if you're not prepared to contribute to the greater good of a society by getting vaccinated, which helps to protect all of the other people in society, then you shouldn't get to benefit from all of the privileges of being a part of that society.
Yes, so people will certainly say that. And I think there's a degree of frustration in New Zealand at the moment that leads, you know, people to that kind of conclusion. So a few things to consider there. Obviously, if someone breaks the law, in some cases we remove their right to free participation in society and we might imprison them. I think it's a really big step, though, to say that because you've chosen not to take a voluntary health service, you've refused a health service, that you no longer are able to participate in some elements of society. And I suppose prior to the announcement, I was expecting maybe the certificates would be used for large events, concerts, you know, events over 1,000 people, and I can see that there's more justification there, and this is the idea of kind of least infringement. Mm. But if they're going to be used in gyms, cafes and so on, then, you know, I think it's just a big shift for us to say that participating in that community and social life is now a privilege that the government gets to allocate to people, as opposed to an entitlement that we have as part of our civil liberties. And so again, maybe that's justified, but part of the obligation of the government is to do that justification. Mm. And so I felt like we haven't heard that yet. Obviously the Prime Minister had a lot to cover in her talk, but I hope that justification's coming, and I think New Zealand's entitled to it.
Let me flip the argument on its head for a moment. What are the ethical implications of deciding not to get a vaccine and potentially putting other members of your society at risk?
Sure. So I think we need to think about the reasons people haven't got vaccinated. And there is certainly a group of people who have had access to good information and have made that choice. And that is a choice that impacts their own health but impacts other people's health as well. But we do know from the data that a lot of people that haven't got vaccinated, you know, there are various reasons for that. So some people have, you know, complex daily lives. Finding the time to get to the vaccination centre is difficult. People are concerned about side effects. I was in bed sick for 2 days after my second dose. People in those circumstances might need care and support themselves. They might need care for their children. They need to know they can take that time off work. And we certainly know, for example, that there's specific communities where we have lower vaccination rates. Māori, for example, there's good reasons for distrust in the medical system based on a history of colonialism and ongoing institutional racism. So we really need to kind of address those base concerns. I think another group that we're starting to see recognition for, which is really important, is low vaccination rates amongst those who use mental health and addiction services. That's obviously a vulnerable community who may have distrust in the system as well. Whānau that have insecure housing. So it's just really problematic, I think, if we simplify the narrative and say it's just a choice and people have just chosen not to help their community. And that very narrative risks further stigmatising and marginalising communities that are actually vulnerable, and we need those communities to engage with the system as much as possible. Right? We need them to get tested. If they get COVID or get sick, we need them to come to health services. So I think we have to be really careful about the rhetoric and the narrative we're using, even if we decide that some form of vaccine passport is necessary.
Yeah, so to be clear, you still think that at some point we have to relax some of the restrictions and potentially consider using a vaccine passport, but it's really around the messaging and as you put it, the narrative as we use those tools or make those decisions.
Yeah, there's a few other things I'd like to see as well, and this comes down to the justification, right? So if we're clear on the ethical justification, we can put the appropriate evaluation mechanisms in place to see if we're reaching that target. Mm. If the target is to protect the health system, we need to be tracking how many staff are leaving the health system versus getting vaccinated. I really would like to see a sunset clause in there and periodic evaluation of the vaccine passports and certificates to see when we might be able to remove them. Mm. Israel, for example, introduced them in February and then removed them in June, and that was set up in advance. That sunset clause was built into the process. I think we would want to think about France's model, where they don't just require vaccination. People also have the option of having been tested negative within the last 72 hours. That's, again, less restrictive than just relying on vaccination. So there's a few things that I'd like to see built in as we move forward.
Were you and other members of the Immunisation Implementation Advisory Group consulted about the certificates plan or the government's plans on Friday?
We were consulted about the use of vaccine certificates internationally. We didn't have a substantive dialogue about the use of domestic certificates. Broadly, I think that is frustrating. I mean, Israel introduced these in February. It was obvious that this is going to be part of the potential toolkit. For the Prime Minister to say in August this isn't on the cards and then to announce that it is the primary backbone of the strategy moving forward doesn't facilitate public discourse and dialogue. Mm. And I think a real strength of the New Zealand system is those really strong, robust, deliberative processes. and that encourages public trust, right? So New Zealand has very low corruption rates, high transparency, high expectations of openness in government, and that all is part of the social fabric that allows us to trust one another and to trust the government and to move forward as one. So I really would have liked to see the government facilitate more dialogue about this. And we can do that moving forward.
And would you have expected to be consulted?
Well, in the end, these are cabinet decisions. You know, cabinet has the political mandate to make these decisions. We would certainly have liked, or I would have liked to have been consulted more about it. But I suppose my concern is not so much the consultation, but the public dialogue, right? So the public really needs to be brought along. And I think previously the Prime Minister's done a great job, and you know, when coercive measures are necessary, of explaining that there are a balance of interests, there are different considerations, and why certain approaches are necessary. Yeah, and so it's not so much about me not being consulted, it's more about ensuring that the public understands and can see a clear justification for why these measures are necessary.
This is such an interesting conversation. Thank you so much for your time. And before we let you go, te kino o te atahu o te waiata, you are a star for bringing your own theme music this morning and and being interviewed seamlessly right throughout.
Beautiful Wellington.
Yeah, we really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Associate Professor Angela Ballantyne from Otago University.